Eric for the next 3 years, so it has been only 3 months, even not 2 months. So it's very rough, but it's just to show you the new direction of research and also to try to help us rethinking the social changes that we are noticing in Central Asia. And I think it's also a way for us to understand better the failure of Western influence in Central Asia, or at least the disappointment both by the West towards Central Asia and by Central Asians toward the West. So trying to look at social changes and not only at external actors and their influence, even if of course it's very important. So when I was trying to think about what means this kind of rising conservative values narrative that we find in Central Asia, I suddenly realized that, in fact, many of these elements were already there in the narrative built by the Central Asian state around nation building and nationhood. So we have already a huge literature discussing nationhood in Central Asia, but it's just that we never connect it to political culture. We always see it as the state narrative about being independent and we need to have our own narrative about our own nation. But we never really looked at what it would mean for the population in terms of political culture, because that there is no real classic political offer in the sense of parties you would vote for in Central Asia. We never made that connection about what it means. But if you look in nationhood process, you will see, for example, a narrative about our true national values. Well, that was already there since the early 90s, and so it's spreading now among the society on many aspects, but that's a state-produced narrative. The focus on ethnicity, revisiting history, trying to look back in history to say that the real value, they are back. They are not forthcoming, they are in the past. All these elements, they were already there in the nationhood process in the early 90s. We also have important trend that we try to probably understudied in Uzbekistan, and that's a specific case, but you can find more or less similar processes in the other country. The state has produced kind of new national ideology that are taught in school, in universities, about spirituality, morality, ethics, etiquettes, national mentality. All these elements, they are already there, produced by the state since the 90s or the early 2000s. Then if you follow a little bit Central Asian youth policy and the usual ministries of youth, you will see that they are reproducing a narrative which is very kind of Soviet style on many aspects, but which is discussing about how to have traditional sexuality reproduction mechanism of the youth. If you look at the Muslim spiritual board, they share similar discourses about what they consider as the social norms that the society should share. And then you have many traditions that have been kind of revamped in the new context. If you look on social media, the discussion about bride kidnapping in Kyrgyzstan that is sometimes celebrating as the Kyrgyz national tradition, we should be proud of, etc. So all these elements, they were already there in the atmosphere since a very long time. It's just that we never labeled them as being part of a kind of conservative way. If we look at what other, and I will show you kind of several element or social niches where I feel this kind of conservative emerging, that doesn't mean they are all the same. They are all a different element. Maybe they're not always overlap. We see, of course, Islamic values on the right. That's a flyer that I like very much, coming from Dushanbe, inviting you for Sharia-friendly, high-level, high-style vacation in Dubai. So we have sociological data telling us that one-third of the Kyrgyz and Tajik population is in favor of some kind of Sharia implementation. If we look at the data, and we have in fact very detailed data done by the Pew Center, we see that it's not only informal justice system that is pushed to be progressively Islamized, because usually when people say they want something related to Sharia, it's linked to the social justice issues, or to the denunciation of corruption. When we look at the data we have for Kyrgyzstan, for example, about so this one-third of the population asking for more Sharia, when we ask them, what do you mean by Sharia, we have very clear data. They mean physical punishment for adultery, segregation or discrimination in the public space for non-Muslims, and so on. So it's already very kind of well-formulated narrative that we were not used to see in Central Asia. We also have data that show that the identification to being a Muslim, whatever it means, is now almost total for all the titular nationalities in Central Asia. The latest one where the Kazakhs in 2007, two-thirds of the ethnic Kazakhs were considering themselves as Muslim, so one-third was not. 2012, same sociological data, same study, same group, 98 or 99%. So in only 5 years, the identification to, if I'm an ethnic Kazakh, I'm a Muslim, whatever it means, has been really kind of bumping. So all these elements, they are there in the kind of the atmosphere. We also have information of the rise of some religious practices, and usually what is the most practiced, it's not, of course, everyday prayer, it's Zakat and Ramadan that are really growing up in all the five countries. I mean, we don't have a lot of data for Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan, we have mostly for the three other, but very visible rise also in Kazakhstan. We also have data that show us how religious identification is really changing among migrants when they are going to Russia. And we also have data showing us how proselytizing groups like Tablighi Jamaat are really able to influence the way young people in migration during their stay in Russia will change both their religious identification and their religious practices. And what we see emerging, and we have several scholars working on that now in Russia, all having the same kind of data, is that when you go to Russia as a migrant, you live at the Tajik, at an Uzbek, at a whatever nationality, and you come back with the feeling that your religious identity is more important or is rising in importance toward your ethnic identity. So the religious element is kind of becoming more and more prevalent. We also have the rise of what we call bourgeois Islam among middle classes that's very visible in Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and in Tajikistan. And what we have been calling Dubaization of lifestyle, and this is one of these examples. It's very trendy now if you are among this kind of middle classy that consider that religion is important, then the fashion, both in terms of lifestyle and of clothes and of cultural practices coming from Gulf countries and especially from the Emirates, will be very powerful. So we were used to think about Turkey and Iran as the kind of main countries bringing something related to Islam to Central Asia. But it seems, in fact, it's the Gulf countries who are now, and the Emirates in particular, who are taking the lead. And then globally, a lot of anecdotal evidence showing us kind of social horizontal pressure on gender segregation, on female clothes going on everywhere in Central Asia, including among urban middle classes and elites. That's really part of the general narrative now in the region. What we see also rising is the new wave of ethno-nationalism very visible in Kyrgyzstan, in Kazakhstan. If you look at social media, you have really new generation of activists who are kind of pushing for reformulating ethno-nationalism. It's often going with anti-colonial narrative, with a revival of anti-Russian position, especially in Kazakhstan, and very often as an indirect critique of national government. One of the great examples, if you want to look on social media, the Kazakh ethno-nationalist Facebook group, Kazakh Orda, is one of the best. They are very good in doing visual memes, and you can see, so for example, for those of you not reading Russian, so showing that, yeah, Putin has been criticizing Ukraine leaving, exiting the Soviet Union, but in fact, Moscovia exited the Golden Order, also not very legally, and therefore, in a sense, Russia is still a part of the Turkic world. Something also very important that has been largely understood until recently, and there have been research done in Bishkek by a group of scholars recently, is the real fashion for folk history and kind of genealogy. It's really impressive, and it's really a mass phenomenon, especially in Kyrgyzstan and Kazakhstan. If you go to the small bookshops at the train station and you look at literature that would be not in Russian but in Kazakh and Kyrgyz, you will be mostly read this kind of folk history, rewriting for kind of popular rewriting of the national history and very much with an ethno-nationalist narrative. What we see growing also is youth vigilantism. Here also mostly Kyrgyzstan and Kazakhstan. So Kyrgyzstan are probably the most violent group. In Kazakhstan, they have been less violent, but they are still having a lot of activities. It's mostly gender issue centered, so it's really kind of trying to criticize women who will not have the right clothes, who will be dating someone who is not from the titular nationality. They have been organizing protests against Western investors, against Westerners globally, against Chinese representatives. Many also action anti-LGBT groups, sex workers. So it's more or less both in Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan the same kind of narrative, but the Kyrgyz groups have been more violent in the street. What is interesting for the Kazakh group and Bolashak, one of the main group, and I wrote Bolashak with this letter, not conflate it with the Bolashak state run program for sending future civil servants abroad. They are also interesting because they are not only criticizing and having violent actions against those they consider are not respecting national value, they also worked a lot with rural youth and with oral man. They are, for example, collecting books and sending them to rural libraries. So there is a really real social work going on there. It's not only being in the street and beating those you consider your enemies. Globally, what all these narratives are telling us is that Western values are not kind of adapted for the Central Asian context, and usually we kind of can classify the relationship to the vision of Western values through several prisms. The first one is, of course, conspiracy theories that are really important, either saying that the West, and especially the US, are against Islam, or that just globally Central Asia has been a puppet for great powers and is tired of being consider like that. The other narrative is to say that Western values are the foreign agenda imported from abroad, that democracy failed, that market economy is difficult, and I think that the key element, that the social cost of reform has been underestimated by Western actors, while it has been considered as central for the region, and that Western values are coming with too many conditionalities in transforming the societies, including LGBT issue that have been this last year one of the big kind of focus. And then also a narrative about foreign aid and foreign investor are in fact disempowering local communities and not really empowering them. So that's the kind of mainstream narrative that we can find in the region. Last point that we see emerging is that even if Central Asian societies are not democratic societies, with the exception of Kyrgyzstan, and that's a complicated definition. We see some political actors who more and more base their political legitimacy on making open, clear statements about their conservative value, their relationship to ethno-nationalism, their relationship to Islam. In Kyrgyzstan, there have been several political parties that really promoted these conservative values, but in Kazakhstan, you can now identify also several political figure who are like really openly bringing that narrative in the public space, which was really not there a few years ago. So on that, the two countries are really moving forward in allowing a certain public space to be filled out with narrative about conservative values, either on the side of ethno-nationalism or on the side of Islam. Very briefly, some sociological data we had from Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan. We will have more once we will be running some surveys with Eric, but that just to show you some of the data we already have. You can see that Western values are largely deconsidered by Kazakh and Kyrgyz youth, that the Russia model is a little bit higher, but not so much. So Russia is influential on many aspects of its soft power, but it's also not really considered as a model. If you ask, are you in favor of Russia in the kind of the in world affairs perspective, then the Central Asian society will be largely pro-Russian. If you ask them, do you see Russian society as a model, then the number will be really lower, because the majority of people, and that's youth-centered survey, will say that we should have our own values and our own kind of model of development. So very briefly, some conclusion. I don't think if we want to understand what is happening, we shouldn't be saying only that, oh, it's just, you know, the rise of Islam or Islamism, or it's just Russian media influence. There are real grassroots homegrown movements that are in line with the worldwide trend of kind of the rise of conservative values globally. I think the nationhood narrative that the Central Asian state elaborated already in the 90s is now kind of generated values as a political agenda. So there is a kind of translation from the nationhood centric narrative to the kind of political culture of everyday citizen that can be centered on these conservative values. In a sense, when we are looking at these youth vigilantism groups, we can probably on many aspects identify them as a kind of far right in a very different context, but in a sense they are the skinhead of Central Asia on many aspects, at least for Kyrgyzstan. And that's, so if we try to apply the kind of the tools, the analytical tools we have for studying this right of far right, then maybe it works also for some of these elements we can see in Central Asia. I think the key element is that the cost of one quarter of century of violent social changes is kind of telling us now that this rise of conservative values, for the majority of people, it's understood as being just back to normality, just having a society where things are changing slower and where things are just kind of a little bit stable so people can project themselves and their identity in something that is more stable. So the notion of normality and being back to a normal society is, I think, something very important to understand what is happening. It seems that that has to be developed, but clearly in Kazakhstan, ethnic repatriated, so about 1 million people, so 10% of the ethnic Kazakh population in Kazakhstan are repatriated people, it's already a big number, and internal migrants are probably one of the social groups that is the one carrying out this conservative values narrative, but clearly we also have a middle classes phenomenon, with middle classes, urban middle classes, having to create kind of ideological mechanism to cover up and justify their new status and kind of explain the gap in standard of living, while at the same time think that, okay, maybe I'm rich and I'm living in better condition than you, but we share something in terms of our identity and our values. Globally, of course, and both Alex and Eric were discussing that in their presentation, the West, so-called Western liberal order is little attractive and it has clearly to be redefined if you want to be formulated as a kind of soft power. The rise of these counter-norms that Alex was discussing, I think it's not only at the elite or institutional level, you see it in the societies. And so all the Central Asian state narrative about securitization of the border, of the regime, of whatever you want, it's really also replying, it's in resonance with the need for securitization of individual life and individual identities and values. And so probably one of the research agenda that we will be developing in the forthcoming months, year, and to try to kind of, the majority sociological studies we had or anthropological studies we had in Central Asia was very often minority-centered and elite-centered. And so in a sense, now we are at this stage where we need to try to get the big picture of the majority public opinion to realize that we need to move up from looking at just the elite level and trying to understand what is happening really at the ground level. And in that case, that would just give us a kind of better picture to understand how Central Asian societies are changing faster than we imagine and how it would be difficult for so-called the West to adapt to this change and to be able to offer an ideological a program that would make sense for Central Asian societies. And I will stop here.